Now, if we have been united with him like this in his death, we will certainly also be united with him in his resurrection. For we know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be done away with, that we would no longer be slaves to sin, because anyone who has died has been freed from sin. Now, if we died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. For we know that since Christ was raised from the dead, cannot die him. Death no longer has mastery over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. On the night Jesus was eating the Last Supper with his disciples, he stood up, took the bread, asked God to bless it. He tore it in two and said, "This is my body broken for you. As often as you come together, do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, when they had finished eating, he took the cup, asked God to bless it. Gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, drink of this, all of you. This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, shed for you. As often as you come together, do this in remembrance of me."
Today's scripture reading is from Psalm 66, verses 8 through 20, from the New International Version. "Praise our God, all peoples, let the sound of his praise be heard. He has preserved our lives and kept our feet from slipping. For you, God, tested us. You refined us like silver. You brought us into prison, laid burdens on our backs. You let people ride over our heads. We went through fire and water, but you brought us to a place of abundance. I will come to your temple with burnt offerings and fulfill my vows to you. Vows my lips promised and my mouth spoke when I was in trouble. I will sacrifice fat animals to you and an offering of rams. I will offer bulls and goats. Come in here, all of you who fear God. Let me tell you what he has done for me. I cried out to him with my mouth. His praise was on my tongue. If I had cherished sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But God has surely listened and has heard my prayer. Praise be to God, who has not rejected my prayer or withheld his love from me. May God add his blessing to the great nation.
Let me at him. So they tried to put armor on him and try to give him a sword. This isn't going to work. I can't even walk with this stuff on. Just give me my sling and a few rocks and let me go at it. Well, they all think he's crazy and try to talk him out of it, but he said, nobody is going to talk that way about my God. Nobody is going to put my God down like this. And we know the rest of the story. He went down and picked up some nice pebbles that were just exactly the right size for his sling. And he goes down there and whop, pops Goliath in the forehead and puts him down and takes his sword and cuts his head off. And the Philistines say, whoa! And they run, and there's a great rout that day, and the Israelites win a wonderful great battle. That's just the first part of David. If there comes a time in our lives, and some people are saying this may be coming closer to us than we think, when we have to stand up and defend our God, and is there times we should be defending our God when we're not? That we're backing up and saying, well, Are we standing up and defending God the way we should be as his disciples? David would not have any of this. He knew the Lord was with him, and he knew the strength of God was with him, and the strength of God came over him. And that gave him power, gave him courage, and he stepped out and said, here I am, bring it on. There comes a time when we really have to defend our God and have to stand up and step out. Are we ready to do that? Is our faith that strong? There's lots more in David's life. Saul chases him around all over the countryside, and there's many, many times that it looks like that Saul has him cornered, and we see Psalms, to me, is sort of like a diary of David. It's David's diary. He's writing every day. There's 150 Psalms. Now, not all of those are written by David, but most of them are. And I'm taken by how much time David spent in communication with God, in personal communication. And that's one thing about the cell phones. I talked to the seniors about the other night. The cell phone is a tool, but when we worship that cell phone, when we spend all of our time with that cell phone, and we're just being entertained and getting information over it all the time, are we spending our time in the right place? Are we spending our time where it should be? Or should we be like David and be out in the open and seeing everything around us, seeing the green grass, seeing the quiet waters, seeing the bramble bushes and all of the surrounding area, but being at one with God and being in constant communication with God. When we look at Psalms, a lot of times he's praising God. You lifted me up out of the mire. You brought me up, and you set my feet on a rock. You set me on a high place, and you dressed me up, and you made me beautiful, and I'm standing on a high rock. The next time it may be, Lord, are you really there? Are you really there? I cried out, I didn't hear anything, I didn't get any answer. What's going on? Where are you? And then there may be another time that David says, Lord, the enemy has me surrounded. I have no chance. I'm destitute. I'm hungry. I'm starving. I'm down. I'm just about to go. Where are you? What's going on? They may see you. The next time you may say, I give up. I totally surrender. I just give up. It's just too much. I can't do it all. So Psalms is kind of like a diary of David. But today, Psalm 66 He says, shout to the Lord. Shout to the Lord. It's wonderful. It's great. It's good. And we think, David, do you really believe? Do you really have that much faith? You're shouting to the Lord one day, and the next day you're questioning whether he really is and really is there for you. And the next day you're completely giving up. What's going on here? But aren't we a lot the same way? If things don't go right, don't we say, Lord, what's going on? What are you doing to me? Today, David says, shout to the Lord. Give it up. Let the world know. Let the world know that we believe in God and we trust God, and that he is our God. He is our Lord and Savior. Shout to the Lord. Give it up. Praise our God, O people. Let the sound of his praise be heard. Is the church too quiet? Is the church too quiet? Are we not working into our conversations, our faith? Are we not in communication and one with God enough to work that into our conversations? Like, the Lord has really blessed me today. Had a fellow in my hometown that asked me how things were going, and he said, you know, Ken, the Lord has just really blessed us. The Lord has just really blessed us. And it was always that way. And you know, an answer like that makes a difference. When we testify to what God is doing in our life and what's going on in our life, and that God is part of our life, it makes a difference. It's impressive to people. Like, wow, that guy is a believer. And he trusts in God. And he's in communication with God. You know, he's doing well. And he doesn't mind sharing it. He doesn't mind telling people. Shout to the Lord. Let the praises be heard. Now, we walk out the door and we think, wow, enjoyed worshiping today. That was good. And then we forget. We don't go into the restroom and say, I know you're not going to do this. Well, we had a good worship service today. That preacher was fired up and he was going. He talked all about David and everything that David did, David's diary. And wow. We want to just tell everybody in here, we had a great worship service. No, we don't need to do that. But you know, we can be really, really respectful and loving to every person we come in contact with. We can work those words into our conversation. We can tell people almost underhandedly that God has blessed us and we're thankful to God. And that's what David's doing here. David's saying, praise the Lord and let the voice be heard. Get it out there. Tell people. Shout to the Lord. We're a little reserved, a little quiet. We live our faith, and that's important to us. And living it is a lot stronger than saying it. But it's like my father was. My father lived out his faith to the T. He was an honest man. And when he did business, a handshake was enough. He didn't have to have a contractor. He didn't have to have papers. But whatever he said, that was the way it was. And my great-grandfather bought into a bank in town, and that bank went under, and they fed out cattle for 3 or 4 years to pay back every cent of the bank owed anybody. His partner kind of ran off with what was left. But so that came down. That's a really, really powerful story in my life. And it's made a difference in who I am, but it made a difference in who my father was also. He lived it out. He lived it out with power. But it would have been so nice to just heard the words. You know, Living's one thing, talking about it's another, and we need to do both. We need to do both. We need to live it first. That's the most powerful thing, but we need to talk about it too. There's nothing wrong with words. There's nothing wrong with communication, and we've absolutely got to have it. He has preserved our lives and kept our feet from slipping. Most of us have had on Sunday shoes that have no grip on them and have had the occasion to be on ice sometime or another. And when you're on wet ice and you have those Sunday shoes on and don't have any grips on them whatsoever, you're sliding, and if you're on an incline, you may end up at the bottom of the incline. And that's a bad feeling. You're out of control. You don't have any control. You don't have that grip there. God has kept our feet from slipping. And David sees so many times in his life that the Lord has given him tread, that the Lord has been there for him and given him a solid base to stand on. For you, O God, have tested us. You have refined us. Most of us have been through something in our life that was a test. And a lot of us have been through lots of tests. Where else do we go? What else is it? But a lot of people turn away. A lot of people find something else to believe in, to trust in, to draw strength from, or just to escape. Just to escape. But David's looking back across his life. And can't we do that? And doesn't that strengthen our faith when we look back across life and we see where God was there and he did answer those prayers, even though at the time we may not have felt like that he was answering those prayers? And he goes on to say, you let people trample over our heads. And I was thinking, if you fall down on the ground, you think you're going to get run over, or a bunch of calves are coming at you, what are you going to protect? Well, you're going to protect your head. Well, David is illustrating the worst thing that can happen to you is having your head trampled on. And he said, wow, we really got tested. We really got stomped on. Wow. Our people have been tested, but we came through the fire. And Lord, you led us to a place of abundance. You brought us out. Are we not in a place of abundance right now? Are we not in a good position? Are we not in a good place? We're safe. We're secure. We have everything we need. I've probably got enough food in my refrigerator for meals all week. We are very, very blessed. I will come into your temple with burnt offerings and will fulfill my vows to you, vows my lips promised when my mouth spoke when I was in trouble. When the Lord answers those prayers, and we look back across life and we see where God was there, undoubtedly, had to be. It had to be the Lord. It couldn't have been anything else. It couldn't have been anything else. But God made the difference. God made the difference when David stood up in front of Goliath and said, you're not going to insult my God that way. I'm not going to have it. If I die right here, that's all right. But I am not going to have you insulting my God. Do we remember to say thank you when a prayer is answered? Do we remember to say thank you when we see that God has been in our lives and he has made a difference? He has kept our feet from slipping. If you've ever climbed a mountain, you would know it's not a good idea to have your feet slip. It's not a good idea. But God is there for us. And he forgives us by his grace and his mercy and his love. said, "I am so thankful. I am so thankful that God listened and heard me." And aren't we all thankful that God listens and that God hears? That God knows and knows everything about us and still loves us enough to send His Son to die for our sins? God certainly does listen. He hears. He's there. Always. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for the life of David. We thank you that we can read of the faith that he had, never denying you, even when you challenged him. Lord, we thank you for the faith that that gives to us. We thank you that we should be shouting out our faith. Lord, be with us today and be with us this week. Help us to live out our faith and help us to find a way to communicate that faith by words, that it may have power and may result in seeds sown for your kingdom. In your name, amen. Thank you. To the world.